everybody, and welcome to Videoversity. I'm Hill Bowers alongside Joanna Musser, and we have a wonderful program set up for you today. That's one thing you can always count on here watching Videoversity. We always have the most interesting, we've got the interesting stories for you. That's no different today. What do we have, Joanna?
Today, first we have going into the Multicultural Affairs with Dr. Hardy.
Now that's a brand new, they kind of changed the name. Now it's the Multicultural Affairs Department. As Joanna said, Dr. Hardy heads that up. We'll be talking to him. That's Janie Clark's segment a little bit later on. What else do we have?
And we have the Campus News College Station of WVVS, 90.9 FM.
Now, a lot of people are confused. A lot of people don't even know that we have a college radio station. We're trying to get that word out to people today. 90.9 on your dial. Just switch them on. Some interesting programming.
And then we also have the body piercing of
Body piercing. A topic that, you know, Dr. Klein was mentioning last week that no topic is too sacred for Videoversity. We'll
That's
be
right.
talking about body piercing. And a little later on in the program, we are going to get up close and personal with one of our new professors, Mr. Taylor. He'll be joining us following the body piercing segment. Now it's time to toss it to our first segment, which is Multicultural Affairs with Janie. Take it away.
You're watching Videoversity. I'm Ed McNeal. Today we'll be speaking with the assistant to the president in the VSU's Equal Opportunity Programs in Multicultural Affairs, Dr. Jerry Hardy. Stay tuned. Videoversity will be right back.
Multicultural Affairs is a new name for our office. We were the Office of Minority Affairs and Affirmative Action. As of the 1st of January, we became the Office of Equal Opportunity Programs and Multicultural Affairs because we wanted to become more inclusive. We wanted students, faculty, and staff to know that this was not an office just for African American students. And Affirmative Action and Minority Affairs had the connotation that we only worked with African-American students, which is far from the truth. As the Office of Equal Opportunity and Multicultural Affairs, we supervise Affirmative Action, the Minority Achievement Program, Americans with Disabilities, our Special Services program, and we also work with students who might have problems related to Title IX. As you know, Title IX is an effort to be more inclusive in terms of women. We work very hard to increase the number and the participation of African Americans on campus. This is the Minority Achievement Program. Of course, this is a program that we're now changing the name to the VSU Achievement Program because we want any student that needs help in terms of any academic area that they want some support in, we'll help them. What we do through the Achievement Program is to assign peer advisors who are upperclassmen to a group of students, and that responsibility is to work with those students, help them understand the problems of being in college, and hope that they'll start out early on doing those things that will assure them in some way of being able to stay here as a student in good standing. And so we've been very successful with that. We do a lot of diversity work. We do a lot of seminars. We bring a lot of people to the campus, various groups to the campus, to try and sensitize people to the differences that exist in our society and various cultures, such that people will have an understanding of them. We try to make sure that the institution is in compliance in terms of Title IX, because there are certain provisions that we have to make for females in terms of athletics, in terms of the number of programs that we offer for females, and that's what Title IX is all about, is making sure that females on our campus have an equal opportunity to participate in a certain number of athletic programs. And thankfully, VSU is in compliance in all of those areas. The program has, as it is now, because we've grown over the years. We started out over 10 years ago, at least I did. We did have an affirmative action officer on campus prior to that, but I've been in this position for 10 years now. And of course, we've expanded the services. Well, we're never where we ought to be, as far as I'm concerned, and so we have to continue to work hard. We are far better than than most institutions in the university system, but that's only what we're responsible for doing. We're supposed to be that way. I'm glad that Valdosta State University is one of the leaders in that area, but system-wide, we've not done what we ought to do, and we want to get better here at Valdosta State University. And that's one of the things that's so impressive to me about VSU is that we're constantly trying to get better. I probably speak to 50 or 60 high school groups a year in some form or another. I'm certain that that has some impact on recruitment of African-American students or any student, whatever the audience is, because many of our audience is majority students. I think it has an impact on the people who come to Valdosta State University. I like to think so anyway. Well, we serve sort of as a mediation unit. We settle many disputes, some between students, some between faculty and staff, some between faculty and students. And what we try to be is an uninvolved negotiator in terms of disputes that may go on anywhere on campus. Very closely, because a number of times we collaborate with other institutions in terms of bringing some noted individual to the campus, and if that person's in the area, we share the cost among institutions. I normally do 10 or 12 work ops on other campuses every year in terms of areas related to diversity. And that way we are able to set up an exchange of some sort. Many times I get advice from persons on other campuses in terms of what they're doing. And so we do a lot of sharing, as much as we can anyway. There are a number of things that we're doing that we've tried to pattern from other institutions, and we try to do them, of course, better. We want to start a program where we reward students in some way for excellent work. And we've gotten some ideas from other institutions, and we're going to try some of those things here. We're going to ultimately employ a person in this office with some legal training to make sure that we examine very carefully the legal aspects of certain things that happen on campus, and this person will help us make sure that we're in compliance. So there are some changes that we want to make with the office, because we're always looking to improve. I'm originally from Brunswick, Georgia, attended Clark College, now Clark Atlanta University. Attended Fisk University on a National Science Foundation Fellowship. Left there and went to Northern Illinois University in DeKalb, Illinois. Became a school principal in Illinois, stayed in that position for 8 or 9 years. Returned to Georgia, to Fort Valley State College, where I worked for 8 years, and I've been at Valdosta State University since that time. I also teach courses in the College of Education. I've worked for the past 8-9 years teaching research and statistics classes for the College of Education in the cooperative doctoral program at Georgia State University. I enjoy teaching. I continue to teach VSU 101 classes, and so I try and very much to stay in touch with what's going on in the academic arena. I also speak in a lot of classes on campus on issues of diversity, especially affirmative action. And so I still get into the classroom quite often. Well, we're located across from the University Union in the Siegel House, and we'd like to encourage students, faculty, and staff to come by and see us. We especially encourage students to come, simply because here's a place where you can come and get some advice on good study habits, how to take notes, how to get things done in the classroom, how to approach a professor, how to make sure that what you're doing is appropriate for what you've been asked to do. And so we certainly encourage students to come by. Normally we speak to students doing insight, and we let parents know that we're here. And so we get a lot of calls from parents asking us to check on students to see what they're doing. And we like to make that a collaborative kind of thing where we work with parents and the student for the benefit of the student. And so we'd like to encourage, you know, students to come by and not wait until they're past the point of no return in terms of passing or failing class before they come by.
Teaching.
They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children to jump the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be.
The power to wake up young minds, the power to wake up the world. Teachers have that power. Reach for it. Teach.
Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen.
Reach for the power. Teach. I'm Edward James Olmos, and we're recruiting new teachers. For information, call 1-800-45-TEACH. When you teach the
children. From our Videoversity studios, I'm Hill Bowers, along with Joanna Musser. And Joanna, we were just commenting during the break. Right before we went to break, we were running our Question of the Week segment. Our question of the week that we're running around to students is, what are you doing during spring break? Well, that's a question that I'll pose right now to Joanna. What are you doing?
I'm going to the mountains in Raven Gap, Georgia.
Really? You do any like scaling or rappelling?
No. Oh, no, just mountain climbing.
Hiking.
Oh, hiking and stuff, hopefully.
That's very, very interesting. Yeah. I've always wanted to get out into nature and kind of do the hiking, you know, thing for a while. Coming up next, we have our segment on WVVS, our campus radio station. And Joanna, Harvey will be kind of giving us a tour on that.
And he'll be talking with the music director of Jeff Hewitt and maybe some of the other students that work up there.
Let's turn it over to Harvey.
Harvey Horne, General Manager of WVVS-FM. Let's take a look at the exciting world of college radio. Let's take a look at the studio. Before we get to the studio, this is our lobby. All the posters of the stuff we play here, the names of our staff up here on the wall. If you'd like to come up and look at it, you can. And right in here is the studio. Come on. Yes, this is our studio here at WVVS-FM. We have the turntables here, two of them as needed. The cart machine plays different spots, announcements. Our little board, one of our great DJs, Soda Pop.
Howdy.
Our CD players. Okay, this is our reel-to-reel machine where we play the news and other longer announcements that we have to play. This is our emergency broadcast system equipment, which is too technical to explain in this segment, so that's a whole another segment. This is our format CDs. These are the CDs that the DJs get to pick from when they do their shifts during the day. And as you can see, there's a wide selection of CDs to choose from. Now let's go take it to the music library. And yes, this is our music library, and it also houses our transmitter, so be careful. Radio waves. As I mentioned, this is our transmitter, another segment altogether, so we won't get into that. This is our huge, expansive music library where we have all our records and CDs that we've ever had in the world since our inception back in 1971. These are all all our alternative CDs, stuff that we used to play during the day, and that we also play during requests. Everything else in the music library is played during special shows at night. All right, let's take a look inside the offices here at WVVS where all the grueling behind-the-scenes work goes on. Come on. This office here is the operations manager slash traffic director's office. Both of them share this one desk because we don't have room enough for anybody else. A lot of people ask me where the music we play on our radio station comes from. Well, it comes from in here, the music director's office. Let's take a look. Here's the music director's desk with all the CDs in disarray. And I hope he knows where everything is. And this is our program director's desk. He's the one that decides what special shows to put on the air and when they're scheduled. And he's also in charge of writing up the PSAs and liners that you hear on the air every day. In addition to being the music director and program director's office, this used to be the old studio when we went on the air way back in 1971. Right up here, this is where the microphone was located, and this is where the board was located. And the old board is sitting right over here. And as you can see, it looks ancient.
Hi, I'm Jeff Hewitt, music director here at WVVS, and I'm in charge of putting all this wonderful music on the air. You know, I'm the one who talks to all the reps to make sure they send it to us and report, open all the mail, that kind of stuff. You saw my office. I mean, I just get tons of CDs. Well, is there anything I should add? Am I missing something here? Well, basically, all the new stuff that's any good, I put in the studio there, and usually what we try to do is if another radio station's playing it a lot, we don't play it, because that's basically what the word alternative is supposed to mean, I think, at least in my opinion. Some people don't believe that, but I just don't listen to them. Anyway, I'm Jeff. Thanks for listening to me. Bye.
And that is the exciting world of college radio here at WVVS FM. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.
If you're interested in finding out more about WVVS or applying for a DJ position, visit the station offices on the second floor of the University Union.
Are never easy, but none are as painful as saying goodbye forever. So please help one more person live this year by giving blood just one more time. After all, that one person could be someone you never want to part with.
They allow you to go.
Welcome back to Videoversity. I'm Joanna Musser, and this is Hill Bowers right beside me. And we're going to be going into body piercing next. And Hill,
did you say body piercing?
I said body piercing.
Body piercing. Very, very interesting subject. Actually, I've you may laugh when I say this. I've been thinking of having my cheeks pierced.
Your cheeks pierced. Cheeks pierced.
Wait, did you think I meant no?
No,
not those
cheeks.
Joanna. We're working together a while now. Certainly more conservative than that.
Okay.
No, Chenequea Buckley is going to take us up close and
personal,
in tight with body piercing. Chenequea,
take it
have at it.
Hi, I'm Chenequea Buckley reporting for Videoversity. Today I'm down at a Klein place, a local alternative variety store, where I was able to catch up with Chet Dubois. and talk with him about some of the latest trends in fashion, including one very hot trend, body piercing. Hi, Chad. Welcome.
Hello.
I'd like to ask you a couple of questions about body piercing. The first question would be, where did body piercing originate?
Well, it's really hard to say, even though a lot of African tribes and a lot of Indian type things, whatever, started it, whatever, but it's hard to say.
Okay, do you do body piercings all over, or could you please tell us the areas of body piercings that you do?
I do body piercing in all parts of the human body. Mainly, the most latest commons are tongues, eyebrows, lips, septum, which is the middle part of your nose. That's mainly the part, those are the most common parts that are mainly pierced these days right now.
Hi, do you have any body piercings?
No, I don't have any body piercings.
Well, how do you feel about body piercing?
I think body piercing is neat and it's individuality, but I personally don't want one.
Do you have any body piercings?
No, I do not have any body piercing.
How do you feel about body piercings? Do you think they're cool?
Well, I think it's cool to an extent, you know. A lot of people tend to take it overboard with body piercing in a lot of different places, but all in all, it's pretty good.
Do body piercings hurt?
Not really. The initial piercing, the initial part of the needle going through, yes, there's a little sting, but after that, the body treats it as any part of the body, so it pretty much, pain goes away in a couple minutes, so it doesn't bother much.
Are infections common in tongue piercing?
No, not really. For 3 days, your tongue will probably swell because it's a muscle, and once it gets pierced, it'll swell, but 3 days it should go down and you should be able to eat normal, whatever. Soups and fluids are recommended while for the first 3 days of tongue piercing.
Well, folks, I hope we've answered some of your questions about body piercing. I'm Chenequea Buckley reporting for the Campus News segment of Videoversity.
And this week's question of the week is...
Quick question.
My question is...
Plans off for spring break. What's your plans off for spring break? I don't have any at this particular moment. I'm more during spring break.
Okay. Where are you working?
At a store.
At Target. Looking for a new job.
What are your plans for spring break? I'm going to get up on the floor and lay on the beach and get wasted. Tequila.
Janine woke up in a cold sweat with one thing echoing through her brain. Who was this guy in her bathroom?
Meanwhile, Barry was thinking, whose bathroom am I in?
Janine remembered going to the party the night before and getting smashed out of her mind.
Barry remembered getting drunk and acting really stupid.
Eventually,
the whole evening came back.
Oh, I must be really stupid.
I must be really dumb.
What did I do? How did I get myself into this?
Well, what did I do? How did I get myself into this?
What about... What about AIDS? Then they both realized, much to their relief, that unlike the rest of us...
They were just cartoons.
Get high.
Get stupid.
Get AIDS.
And welcome back to our Videoversity Studios. I'm Hill Bowers alongside Joanna Musser. And Joanna, I'm kind of excited at this point. We have our first guest of our Videoversity season here. And we do want to welcome Mr. Mike Taylor to the studio.
Thank you. You didn't tell me I was the guinea pig.
Yes, we're trying this out with you, so buckle up. No, Mr. Taylor, for those of you who don't know, Mr. Taylor is one of our new professors in the telecommunications mm-hmm. department, where he's kind of feeling yeah. things out. This is his second quarter here, and we want to try and get to know Mr. Taylor just a little bit better. Now, like I said, this is your second quarter here. Mm-hmm. When you were looking at moving, what actually drew you to Valdosta State University?
An interesting set of circumstances. Dr. Klein, who is the head of the telecom area, and I knew each other in Spokane, Washington, where I was working on a doctorate. at Gonzaga University, where he was teaching. And when he left Spokane, he ended up coming here, ironically, to a job that I had previously applied for as well, and realized that, no, I wasn't quite ready at this point to bite off being an academic area head. And then I followed that up with an application the following fall when the program opened up. And from that point, got in here with a last-minute situation. I wasn't able to come for that original interview, and ended up here with Dr. Klein.
Well, listen, it is certainly great to have you on campus, and I'm kind of getting to know you this quarter, and as we all are. So you had mentioned before the show we were kind of talking and chatting. One kind of interesting thing about you that I had no idea about, you say you voice audiobooks.
I've been for about 2 years now reading for an audiobook publisher in Spokane. And it's kind of fun because it forces me to stretch a little bit. I have always, through my radio career, played with my voice, worked out little characters, it'll come out every now and then. And so it becomes a matter of having to create, through the course of an entire book, a variety of characters for all of the various people, and also be able to develop the narration of the book to be able to get the story across, to in effect get inside the author's mind and be able to carry the story through. So, and it becomes a challenge. It's fun.
Well, audiobooks and voicing things like that, it kind of opens a new dimension, you know, of the whole experience. I'm going to kind of put you on the spot here. Use one of those voices and take us to break.
Where are we going into break? Let's see. I think we got a commercial kid up back there. No, we can't do commercials on this channel, can we, Joy? Listen, would you play the PSA or something back there, would you? Huh? Come on, take it away.
In America, you are not required to offer food to the hungry or shelter to the homeless. There is no ordinance forcing you to visit the lonely. In fact, nowhere in the Constitution does it say you have to provide anything for anybody. Thank you for all you've given. Imagine what more could do.
We're back in our Videoversity studios with Mr. Taylor and Joanna, of course, here beside me, my faithful co-host. And we were just reminiscing here and kind of getting to know Mr. Taylor, one of our new telecom professors. Now, you're all into it now. You're into the whole class thing. What classes are you teaching now, and what do you have in
this quarter? I've got the management class and then an introductory course, as well as the radio practicum. And then in the spring, looking forward to doing some interesting different things with the history course and also the intro course one more time.
What are your initial impressions with VSU?
I enjoy it.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for joining us here on Videoversity. I'm Bill Bauer.
And I'm Joanna Messer.
Bye-bye.
I'm eating my chicken, lady.
I mean, I could even better not do that. Hey!
Who's done?
Please pronounce it correctly.
Joe Bauer.
could fix us dinner.
Afton, I gotta tell you, you're making me feel uncomfortable with all you're doing. So, why don't you go home?
All right. Fine, if that's what you want.
I mean, you know, there's no reason for you to hang around here.
You know, Cliff, I'm not working tonight. I could stop by later.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Do that, yeah.
About 8 o'clock?
Mm-hmm. 8 o'clock's fine. See you.
I remember a tenant named Kristen Shepherd, long brown hair, good-looking kid.
Was she pregnant?
I think so.
Well, can you tell us anything about her?
Well, Mr. Ewing, I try to stay out of my tenants' personal lives as much as possible, as long as they pay their rent.
Can you tell us who we can talk to? The names of her friends?
Sure. The girl over there in the blue one-piece suit, named Sharon.
Thank you, Mr. Stromso.
Anytime.
Sharon?
Yes?
I'm Pamela Ewing. This is my husband, Bobby.
Ewing? I've heard that name.
Well, Kristen Shepherd was my sister-in-law.
Kristen? Oh, I read about what happened to her. A friend of mine sent me clippings from the Dallas paper. I knew that guy would get her into trouble.
What guy?
That creep she was living with. What a con artist.
Do you remember his name?
Sure. Jeff Faraday.
Did you spend a lot of time with Kristen?
We did when she first moved in here. Things changed when she and Faraday got married.
She married Jeff Faraday?
Yeah. I stood up for her. It was just downtown at the License Bureau. Not much of a wedding.
When was that?
I'm not very good with dates. Sometime last March. It was right after she knew she was pregnant.
Put up there.
Hi, sweetheart.
Say hi to Mommy.
Hi, sweetheart. Mrs. Chambers, will you take him upstairs and change his clothes?
Yes, Mrs. Ewing. Come along, John Ross.
I'll pick up his toys and be up in a minute. What are you doing here?
Hi, can I come in?
Cliff, I don't want you here.
Well, look, no. I just have to tell you something.
J.R.'s gonna be here any minute, and I don't want a scene.
No, look, look, well, I have to tell you that I shouldn't have asked you to borrow the money. I was panicked, and I didn't know where to turn, and I made a mistake. I shouldn't have done that.
It doesn't matter.
Oh, yeah, but it does, because we had a good thing going, and we could have had a great life, and we still can't.
Cliff, it's getting late and I have change. I just don't want to hear anymore.
Garlin, I need you and I love you. And I've lost everything, but I know I can start over. I know I can build a new life if you just believe in me and love me.
Cliff, I think you should know that J.R. has asked me to marry him. And I accept it. Cliff. I don't want to see you again. Please go.
Well, would you have Detective Howard call me at this number tomorrow, please? Thank you. Well, he's not in.
Bobby, there's something I don't understand.
What's that, honey?
Well, if Kristen and Faraday were married, and Faraday was Christopher's father, why did Kristen put her maiden name on Christopher's birth certificate?
Honey, when Kristen lost that first baby, she could have lost all the money that was coming in from J.R. and Jordan Lee. So she substituted Christopher for the baby she miscarried. And that way, the money keeps coming in indefinitely.
And Faraday continued the blackmail after she died?
Mm-hmm. Using me.
And his own baby?
Yeah, I guess so.
Well, we don't need a copy of the marriage certificate, do we?
This marriage license is not for us. I want something that I can hand J.R. when I tell him this story.
I don't believe it. J.R. is so beautiful. Sable, you're spoiling me.
Mm-hmm. I wanted you to be wearing something special when we went back to South Fork and told Mama the good news.
Oh, our marriage is going to be so wonderful, isn't it?
Just as wonderful as this moment.
Hey, John Ross. You and your mom are pretty as a picture, huh?
Well, I think I'll go upstairs and change into something appropriate to wear with the stable. I'll be right back.
Have you ever seen your mama so happy?
Yeah.
Yeah? You know what I'm gonna do?
Yeah?
I'm gonna take you back to South Fork permanently. We'll be one big happy family.
Yeah.
Of course, I'll have your 10 shares. And with 60 shares, well, I'll be able to run Ewing Oil as I see fit. Hmm?
Yeah. Yeah?
Hi, it's me. I just wanted to make sure you're home.
After I'm home.
Well, I'll be there at 8 then, if that's okay.
Yeah.
Mama?
Thank you, J.R.
And, Donna?
Thank you.
Well, Sue Ellen, you want to tell him or shall I?
No, J.R., you tell him.
Tell us the news, J.R.
Well, come on. It looks like Sue Ellen's about ready to bust.
Well, I've been waiting a long time to stand here and say what I'm about to say. I asked Sue Ellen to marry me, and she accepted.
Oh, that's wonderful. Welcome home, Sue Ellen.
Thank you, Miss Ellen.
You've made me very happy.
Well, here's to the bride.
And to our being a family again.
Cliff? Sorry I'm so late. There was an accident on the expressway. Cliff? Oh, my God, no! Operator, please. I need an ambulance. Hurry, it's an emergency.
Code yellow, ICU.
Did you give him 5% glucose and saline?
Yeah, with 1 amp of dopamine like you ordered. His pressure was 50 over nothing when we got there.
Any external injuries?
No, none. But he looks real bad, Doc. He stopped breathing in the ambulance. We had the bag with him.
Call inhalation therapy. Get a ventilator. Get blood gases. Stat.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, you can't go in there.
I'm with Mr. Barnes.
The doctor's with him now. Why don't you have a seat?
Can I see him?
Not until the doctor says it's okay. Now, make yourself comfortable. It may be some time.
Code blue.
VCU.
Stat.
Afton!
Thank you for calling me. Where is he?
He's in there. We can't go in.
What happened?
I found him unconscious. There was an empty bottle of tranquilizers next to him, and he'd been drinking heavily.
Did the paramedics say anything?
Yes, said a lot of things I just didn't understand. Mrs. Wentworth, he was still unconscious when they carried him out. I don't know if I got there in time.
We've got to believe that you did.
I wish they'd let us see him. Tell us as soon as they know anything.
If Cliff dies, I'm responsible. I turned my back on him. I should have been able to forgive him. He did his best to pay the money back. He tried, Afton.
Don't be so hard on yourself. You don't know all the facts.
Nothing he did is worth his life.
Look, Cliff didn't try to kill himself just because you fired him. There's something else.
I don't understand.
Marilee Stone came to visit. She's in the oil cartel with JR and the others. She told Cliff that she helped JR to set him up. The land he bought was worth nothing. All the geological reports were faked.
Why?
Because JR wanted to destroy Cliff because of Sue Ellen.
Code blue, CCU, stat. Oh, Afton. Code blue, CCU. I knew he and Cliff hated each other. I never thought JR was capable of this.
Did anyone come in with Mr. Barnes?
Yes, the lady over there.
Thank you. Excuse me, is one of you with Mr. Barnes?
I'm his mother. How is he?
He's still comatose. We put him on a respirator.
Will he be all right?
Honestly, it's too soon to tell. Apparently, he swallowed about 50 tranquilizers and, well, that and all the alcohol in his system. You'll be able to see him as soon as he's moved into intensive care. If he makes it. The next 24 hours will be critical. I'm sorry I can't tell you more.
Detective Howard, are you sure there's no mistake?
I'm sure, Mr. Ewing. I have the medical examiner's report right here.
All right, thank you very much.
Anytime.
Goodbye. Faraday's blood type was B. The same as JR's. Pam, that is such a coincidence. I mean, that's why I thought JR was the father, but now there's doubt. Faraday fathered Christopher.
I still can't believe that he sold his own baby.
Faraday was a cheap hustler. But what does that make JR? He thought that Christopher was his son, and yet he was perfectly content to sit back, pretend to be Uncle JR, as long as I voted my 20 shares of Ewing Oil his way. Now, what kind of a man does that?
Well, we all know what JR is.
Yeah, but I hope that deep down inside, when it came to children, he'd have some human feelings, a spark of decency.
Bobby, stop worrying about JR. We've got Christopher. That's really all that matters.
I can't stop him. Now, my own brother tried to blackmail me. And if I have my way, when we get back to Dallas, I'm going to vote to throw him out of Ewing Oil. But not until I take him apart.
Rebecca,
What a surprise.
This is not a social call, Ellie. Rebecca, what's the matter?
Maybe Digger was right. And when I was married to him, I was too young or too stupid to realize it.
What are you talking about?
Digger never had a chance. Jock was too shrewd, too strong and too fast. And now it's happening between JR and Cliff. It's the same fight all over again.
Rebecca, will you please calm down and tell me what's happened?
When I found out that Cliff was using Wentworth funds, I fired him. I think it's time you did the same with JR. He used Ewing funds to destroy my son. Cliff is at Dallas Memorial in a coma. My God. JR set him up. He lost everything. Last night, he tried to kill himself. No.
Oh, Rebecca, I'm so sorry. If there's anything I can do...
I don't want your help. I'm here to warn you. The Barnes-Ewing feud is still going on. It's always been an uneven fight. The rich Ewings against the poor Barneses. Well, now it's even. I swear I'll break the Ewing family. And I have the money to do it.
I have to go to the hospital and see Claire.
No, Sue Ellen.
I have to.
I want to hear it from you, JR. Did Rebecca tell me the truth?
Yes, she did.
And you drove Cliff to attempt suicide?
How was I to know he was going to do a dumb thing like that?
You don't care, do you?
I told you before, Mama, I couldn't stand the idea of him being with Sue Ellen. Now, I didn't force him to embezzle from Wentworth till he died. And I didn't force him to get into a deal that he didn't check and double-check. If that man is dying, it's because of his own greed. Not me.
You're a cold and insensitive man, JR. And I'm going to remove you as president of Ewing Oil just as soon as Bobby gets back.
Well, you don't know it yet, but you won't be able to do that. I'm going to go find Sue Ellen and talk some sense into her.
It's all my fault. It's just too bad Cliff didn't know how guilty everyone felt before he swallowed those pills.
Afton, you must be exhausted. Why don't you lie down in the waiting room?
No. I just want to stay here with Cliff. Everything that has happened, happened because of me. I never realized how much in love with me you were. I should have given you the money. Cliff, please get back.
Sue Ellen.
Look what I've done to him. Look what we both done to him.
Suella. I didn't know it was going to go this far. But he did it to himself.
No, J.R. We did it to him. And I feel so guilty. If Cliff dies, I don't think I'll ever be able to marry him.